Hey everyone, how's it going? Thanks so much for tuning in. For today's video, I'm so excited to bring you an up-close and personal, in-depth look with my new 1965 Ford Fairlane 500 Sports Coupe. I've already put up a couple videos of this already. You can click the link in the top right-hand corner of the video and check it out, including the vlog of when my dad and I drove up to Rhode Island to pick it up, as well as the driving vlog of why I bought the car in the first place, how it relates to some of the other classic cars I've owned, and just why classic cars are special to me. I mean, this is a driving experience that you really just, you can't get from a modern car, and I'll talk about that as we go through this video. As always, this is going to be a detailed, in-depth review of the Sports Coupe. We'll start it up, show the engine, get an exhaust clip, go over the performance data, take it on a thorough road test, and show you many of the unique aspects of both the interior as well as exterior. So without further ado, let's go ahead and hop on in, start it up, and let it run. This example is finished in ivy green. The color code doesn't specify the contrasting light cream roof, so I can only assume it was done when the car received a fresh coat of paint some time ago. Regardless, I absolutely love this color combination. Fairlane hardtops and sports coupes were available with around 15 exterior color choices, including two-tone options like this. They were even available with an optional black or white vinyl roof paired to any exterior color. Inside, you'll find ivy gold pleated vinyl upholstery. Other available colors include red, blue, black, turquoise, and palomino. The Fairlane features recirculating ball steering that is routed through a new for 65 two-spoke 16-inch color-keyed steering wheel with a one-piece chrome horn ring. The Sports Coupe features two metal bands to either side for a fancier touch. You could opt for either manual steering or power steering. Mine is equipped with the latter, but my first Fairlane, the two-door sedan, had the standard manual steering. Both systems featured updates for 1965 to improve response, control, and ease of use. For the manual steering, a new type idler arm bushing was said to provide a significant decrease in the steering system friction, reducing the effort needed during low-speed maneuvers. From experience, I thought it offered enough resistance without it being too overbearing. It still took a bit of muscle, but I always liked that. Of course, it's not for everyone though, as things could get tiring after a while. The steering ratio at 27.8 to 1 is quite a bit higher than the powered setup, but it offers much greater feel and feedback. On the other hand, the power steering system features a new steering gear with a ratio of 16 to 1, leading to an overall ratio of 20 to 1. It takes 3.5 turns to lock versus 4.5 with the manual steering. Having the assistance makes steering a cakewalk, especially when parking. A new power steering pump was added that operated quieter and reduced horsepower losses. The downside is that you pretty much eliminate all feedback and sense of what the front wheels are doing. There's also quite a large dead spot on center that requires you to make adjustments here and there. It was very strange when I first started driving the car, but I've gotten used to it. Despite the lack of feel, the power steering makes the car a lot more relaxing and pleasurable to drive. All 65 Fairlanes have a 40-foot turning diameter. The Fairlane lineup was available with four different transmissions, three manuals and one automatic, depending on which trim level and body style you went with. The manuals consist of a standard 3-speed on the column, a 3-speed with overdrive, and a 4-speed mounted to the floor, paired to a number of standard and optional rear axle ratios. The automatic is shown here as Ford's 3-speed cruise-o-matic transmission. It has two driving ranges, one that uses all three gears, while the other uses only second and third for greater traction when accelerating on slippery roads. The Sports Coupe is unique in that the shifter is relocated to the console versus being on the column like other models equipped with the bench seat. My previous Fairlane was a 3-on-the-tree car, and because it had the same 2-barrel 289 V8 as my Sports Coupe, it had fully synchronized forward gears, which made it an absolute hoot to drive. But when paired with the 6-cylinder, only the 2nd and 3rd gears were synchronized. As expected, the manual was immensely fun and quite different, something I'd recommend for anyone to try out if given the chance. 4-speed 65 Fairlanes are the rarest of them all. I personally have never seen one, let alone drive one. The only way you can get one is with the two higher performing 4-barrel 289s, but we'll discuss engines later in the video. This car still features the original transmission and it performs like it was new. Shifts are smooth and seamless, making the car feel more relaxed and easygoing. A limited slip differential was even available in certain models. Of course, the windows are manual, but with the Fairlane hardtop and Sports Coupe, you have this unique polished trim on the outer edges of the glass, which adds a nice finishing touch. They're very easy to roll down just with the cranks. One thing I thought was pretty cool, and I actually didn't discover this till after I bought the car, this rear window, and this goes both the same for the Sports Coupe and the hardtop, actually rolls into the panel instead of straight down. That's a key difference between my two-door sedan, aside from the B-pillar right here. So with everything down, it just creates a beautiful roof line, a nice open cabin, so you can really cruise down and enjoy a beautiful day with plenty of air coming in.
So let's go ahead and check out the exterior.
Ford launched the 4th generation Fairlane series for 1962. While it received a number of subtle updates in the following couple of years, the 1965 model was the first and last complete revision before the 5th generation debuted for 1966. Therefore, the 65 was a one-year-only body style, which to me makes it quite a cool and uncommon sight nowadays. It was an extensive refreshing that offered all new styling below the belt line and throughout the interior, along with improvements in quality, performance, drivability, and practicality. The Fairlane was available in a variety of body styles, including two- and four-door sedans, a hardtop, and even a station wagon. The biggest difference between the two-door sedan that I used to have and the hardtop is the roof line. It appears thinner than the one used for the sedans, largely due to the wraparound polished drip rail and the lack of a B-pillar. The windshield is raked back further with unique front quarter windows and glass all the way around the car. There's significantly more chrome around the windshield, in addition to a unique finisher around the rear window. The Sports Coupe was a sportier variant of the hardtop. Aside from special badging on the rear roof pillars and deck lid, the changes really pertain to the interior. The Fairlane 500 is a trim package available for the sedans and wagon and standard on the hardtops. The 500 trim added more chrome and luxury touches to dress up the exterior and interior over the base cars, amongst other niceties. The most noticeable additions are the full-length polished side moldings with argent and black painted center sections. Sports Coupe have unique black painted vertical slats on the front fender portions. Also included with the Fairlane 500 is a tricolor red, white, and blue emblem on the hood, more bright work around the windows and sedans, and three parallel polished moldings across the tail end and another tricolor crest on the fuel door. Finishing things off are Fairlane 500 lettering on the rear quarters. Compared to the 64, the 65 is 1.2 inches longer overall, accompanied by a half-inch increase in wheelbase and a 1.6-inch increase in width. It's notably less curvy than its predecessor thanks to the new horizontal body features that gives the Fairlane a larger, wider, and more chiseled appearance. It's not necessarily an exciting design, but it's still a handsome car with a number of cool little body details sculpted in. Ford added close to 90 pounds of sound deadening material throughout the body to make the 65 the quietest Fairlane to date. Up front, there's a new horizontal grille treatment that sits between a pair of horizontal dual headlamp clusters, the latter of which are surrounded by rectangular metal frames. The outer lights are your low beams, while the inner lights are your high beams. This car actually still has its original FOMOCO high beams that work beautifully. At the leading edge of the hood is another strip of polished metal that extends across before meeting up with pieces that wrap around the headlamp clusters and across the bottom of the front lower panel. This creates a continuous rounded rectangle that encompasses the entire front grille and headlamp assembly. Newly styled front and rear wraparound bumpers were said to increase impact resistance. The front incorporates the turn signals and parking lamps. Across the sides, the main defining feature are the high fender lines that continue across the entire length of the car. I like to think of them as vestigial tail fins. The rear portions are highlighted by polished trim. Other cool details include a pair of sharp body lines that begin in the front fenders and angle down to the rear quarters, as well as projecting horizontal lines that begin towards the rear and extend down the body, accentuating the car's overall length and long deck lid. Across the rockers is another strip of polished metal that was standard on all models. The rear end of the 65 broke from tradition of previous Fairlanes by featuring rectangular tail lamps with crosshair or gun sight accents. Backup lamps were an option. If equipped, there would be a clear lens in the center like you see here. Otherwise, there would just be a red cap. Like the headlamps, the tail lamps are surrounded by a rectangular metal housing. The back panel is recessed behind the trailing edge of the deck lid, bumper, and rear quarter flares. A single exhaust was standard on Fairlanes with a 6-cylinder and 2-barrel 289 V8. The other two higher-performing 289s came standard with dual exhaust. We'll talk more about the powertrains in just a bit. As far as the original pricing, the Fairlane started out around $2,182 and $2,222 for the base two-door and four-door sedans respectively. The Fairlane 500 package was about an $80 option. On the other hand, the Sports Coupe began at $2,484, a $158 premium over the hardtop. As equipped, I believe mine's stickered for a little over $3,000. All Fairlane sedans and hardtops came with 14-inch 5-lug steel wheels, wrapped in 14x6.95 bias-ply tires. This one now wears a set of modern 215/75 Cooper Trendsetter radials, featuring a similar white wall pattern as what originally came on the car. In fact, the original tires featured a new lower profile design for greater contact with the road, improved stopping distances, handling, and more. There were three wheel cover options, including the smaller dog dish looking covers on entry models, the Sports Coupe standard deluxe wheel covers, and the optional wire knockoff styled covers like you see here. The Fairlane's brakes continued for 65 with minor changes. They consist of four wheel drums measuring 10x1.75 inches. Revisions to the brake linkages is said to reduce braking effort by 10%. Manual brakes came standard, and that's what's equipped on this one. Power brakes with vacuum assistance was optional, reducing pedal pressure by up to 40%. Regardless of which setup you have, the drums are self-adjusting for the life of the brake linings, helping maintain proper pedal height for easier, more consistent brake application. Driving a car with four-wheel manual drum brakes is an experience. You have to plan your stops well in advance and make sure you leave proper distances between you and the car in front. It's not great at panic stops or rapid deceleration, so it's best to err on the side of caution. That's not to say that the car doesn't stop well, you just have to get used to it. There's a lot of pedal feel, and the stopping force is directly proportional to the force you apply. Unlike most cars today, a car of this vintage really requires your full attention to drive, always being aware of your surroundings. It's so much fun. The Fairlane's front suspension is independent, featuring ball joints and vertical mount shock absorbers with rubber isolated springs and a lower link type rubber isolated stabilizer. At the rear are variable rate Hotchkiss type longitudinal semi-elliptic leaf springs with rubber isolated hangers. The rear shock absorbers are mounted at an angle in that case to reduce side sway, enhancing stability. For 65, the spring rates were softened by 16% up front and 19% in the rear to deliver a softer ride than previous offerings. While not Cadillac soft, it delivers that floaty kind of ride you typically expect from older, large American cars. This leads to poor handling in general, with gobs of body roll and lean when it comes to corners. On the other hand, out on the highway, it's really quite comfortable. Everything seems well insulated, not only with sound deadening, but the way the chassis and suspension absorbs and dissipates minor road imperfections. Overall length is 198.8 inches with a width of 73.8 inches and a height of 54.9 inches. Wheelbase is 116 inches while starting curb weight before options is around 3,000 pounds. 56% of that weight rides over the front. To open the hood, there's a single action release located underneath the grille assembly. Pull it and releases the hood latch and safety catch with one motion. For 1965, the Fairlane was available with either a new 200 cubic inch inline 6-cylinder or one of three variants of Ford's popular 289 V8. The 6 developed 120 horsepower and 190 pound-feet of torque and made up the standard power plant for a variety of Ford cars at the time, including the Mustang. If performance was more your thing, the 289 or 4.7 liter V8 offered a great combination of power and fuel economy. The three variants of it consisted of the entry-level engine like you see here, featuring a two-barrel carburetor, a more powerful four-barrel engine, and the four-barrel high-performance engine. The 289 features cast-iron construction and an overhead valve 90-degree design, with identical bore and stroke dimensions across the board of 4 inches and 2.87 inches, respectively. The base 2-barrel and mid-range 4-barrel have an automatic choke and hydraulic valve lifters, while the high-performance variant has a manual choke and solid lifters. The latter was the top dog of both the Fairlane and the standard Mustang lineup, offering 271 horsepower and 312 pound-feet of torque, quite a bumper of the standard 4-barrel's 225 horsepower and 305 pound-feet of torque. Oil changes are recommended at 6,000-mile intervals. The 2-barrel engine received a bump in compression for 65, up from 9.1 to 9.3, along with revised intake and exhaust porting for improved airflow, in addition to other minor enhancements. The intake and valve covers are painted gold, exactly how it was originally. It's an awesome contrast in person. It develops 200 horsepower at 4,400 RPM and 282 pound-feet of torque at 2,400 RPM. The Fairlane Sports Coupe was tested to hit 60 miles an hour in about 11.9 seconds and passed the quarter mile in 17.8 seconds at 73 miles an hour. Top speed, I imagine, is around 100 miles an hour, maybe a little bit more. It really is quite incredible when comparing the performance to cars today, in a world where four cylinders are able to make well over 300 horsepower. Acceleration is leisurely at best, but even so, the engine still feels strong and delivers power smoothly. The manual transmission options allow you to make the most of the power, while the automatic just makes it a great cruiser. The engine bay in this example has seen a minor refurbish with all the correct tags and decals, a reproduction rotunda oil filter, and more. It runs and drives like a champion. The silver canister you see to the right-hand side is the power steering reservoir. This car doesn't have the air conditioning, a relatively rare option at the time. Off to the far right is a bag for the windshield washer fluid. As far as fuel economy, the 2-barrel was the most thrifty of the 289 range. Along with having a lower compression than the other 289s, it was also the only one that didn't take premium fuel, making it cheap to fill up. Mileage ranges between 15 and 18 miles to a gallon. All 65 Fairlanes carry a 16-gallon tank. Along with the redesigned exterior, the Fairlane's interior was all new. Designed with a horizontal theme with less curves than its predecessor, everything from the trim pieces to the instruments sported a fresh contemporary look. Regardless of the model, the interior styling is pretty much identical across the board. As we discussed with the Fairlane hardtops, including the Sports Coupe, the roofline is sleeker with the lack of a B-pillar. You also have the rearview mirror mounted to the windshield instead of the headliner. The Sports Coupe stood out as it was the only model in the lineup to feature front bucket seats, a folding center console, and a floor shifter. It also featured unique badging in the upper door panels and signature courtesy safety lights in the lower panels, drastically boosting illumination at night. The interior is very roomy for a mid-sized car and seems to be a perfect compromise between the Falcon and Galaxy. This example has been well looked after over the last 50 years. It's without a doubt the most well-preserved Sports Coupe I've ever seen. The interior materials you see here are all original except for the front door panels and the refurbished steering wheel. It's a real time capsule. When stepping up to the Fairlane 500, more or less a fancier trim package, you received higher quality interior appointments and additional bright work to create a more premium looking and feeling environment. Hardtops were only sold as Fairlane 500s. For starters, the carpet is a nylon rayon blend that's said to offer a lot of durability. Yes, this car still has its original carpeting. The instrument bezels are larger, spanning the full width of the dash and surrounding all of the instruments, radio, and heater controls. The seats come standard with a combination of cloth and vinyl upholstery, but these full pleated vinyl seats with metal studs were available at an additional cost. The seats offer fore and aft manual adjustment. The backrest is fixed as far as adjustments are concerned. There's not much in terms of support, but their deep foam cushions keeps things quite comfortable on longer trips. Lap belts were standard in the front, but an option in the rear. On top of that, you can also get retractable seat belts. A couple standout upgrades for 65 included a repositioned ignition switch located to the right of the steering column. Prior years had it mounted to the left. The heater controls in the dash received backlighting for easier use at night. The labels for the lights, wipers, right fresh air vent, and ignition were moved from being on the switches themselves to the lower end of the instrument cluster housing for better visibility. The front and rear armrests were larger and softer, while the rears incorporated chrome ashtrays in the Fairlane 500. The padded door panels feature additional polished trim in the 500 with metal studs dotting across the middle. The glove box is locked in and features a decent amount of storage space. Typical with cars of this time, the dash and door panels are metal. The padded vinyl portions across the middle of the doors look nice, but for a luxurious touch, you can opt for this car's full-length dash pad. It sticks out further than the metal dash, creating like a hood over the instrument cluster, and features additional polished trim. Underneath the left-hand side of the dash, there's a black pull knob for the left fresh air vent and one for the parking brake. A full vinyl headliner was standard. So let's go ahead and see if she sounds. Yeah.
Eagles. Last night was the NBA's night. This is the day that the NBA has taken ownership of.
Go ahead and shut her up.
Like most vehicles for 1965, the Fairlane was pretty simple as far as the available features you can get on it. There were different customizable touches here and there and some dealer-installed accessories, but more or less the Sports Coupe was top of the line. This example pretty much has every available option that you could get for the car in 65. The only one that it does not have is the underdash air conditioning system. Instead, one of the previous owners installed an aftermarket CD player. To each his own as far as these upgrades are concerned. I mean, some people like it, some people don't. But I actually liked that it was already installed because I can make a CD of songs from the 60s and play it in there, which would be cool for car shows and the like, and it is nice to be able to listen to FM stations. The original AM radio actually works, and I'll show that in just a second. Which is pretty cool. With the aftermarket radio, there's two speakers underneath the dash and two in the rear parcel shelf. It's actually a pretty clean install. The dash pad that you see here with the polished trim was optional for some Fairlanes, standard on the Sports Coupe. I actually bought a reproduction one for the two-door sedan that I used to have and found that trim on eBay, so I was able to put it together, but this is actually the original setup. There's no cracks or anything like that. It's in beautiful condition, and I have soaked it in leather conditioner, so it is really supple. It's amazing too when you compare the reproduction ones to the original. You can really tell the difference. Much, much higher quality. Other notable features being that this does not have the air conditioning system, like I said, the car did come standard with a heater, so you have your fan speed here, heat, defrost, and temperature between low or really hot, basically. So like I said, the original AM radio actually still works, and works beautifully. My other Fairlane was a radio delete car, so it did not come with the option of one, but I bought a new old stock radio kit for it, hooked it all up and everything so the light and stuff would work, but I never actually got it working. So this is so cool.
And Scott, you gotta be the athletic director's guy. Mm-hmm. And Magnoli was never that fit. He's going
different presets.
Evening, Juno, Leno, Leno.
Maybe more than any other sport, it's an arms race.
The factory radio is paired with just one speaker mounted right in the middle there. These two ports over there are for the heater vents and the defrost. I love the horizontal speedometer too. You have your odometer in the middle there, vehicle temperature, and fuel, not to mention two warning lamp indicators. As far as the main controls, that black toggle lever down below is for the left-hand side fresh air vent. The right-hand side one is right here. So when you have both of those open, and I showed that earlier, the left-hand one is down there, it'll allow a lot of fresh air and ventilation to come in when you're going down the road, which is quite nice. Your windshield washer jet control is there, and your cigarette lighter. Your ashtray's in the middle of the dash. Like I said earlier, one of the unique things for the Sports Coupe is a full-length center console and floor shifter. There's a ton of chrome trim across either side, the runners across the middle with the silvery trim. It's very, very pretty in person. In the middle, you have a pretty good-sized center console. This one actually has a new liner, but that's exactly how it looked. Very practical. But yeah, so that's a basic overview of the Fairlane's interior for 1965. Go ahead and shut her down and check out the back seat. To gain access to the rear seat, it's very simple. All you have to do, there's no levers or anything like that, you just grab the backrest and flip it forward. Some cars actually flip up and away depending on the model and stuff, but this one just tips forward straight. So like I said, climbing into the back isn't hard. You just grab the backrest and tip it straight forward. One thing I like about this car is the fact that if I wanted to, I don't very often, but if I wanted to carry people back here, I very well could. It's extremely roomy. I'm 5'10", and with the seat set at the particular position it's at, I have maybe 3 inches of leg room, and I'd estimate 2.5 inches of headroom. As you might expect, the back seat is very comfortable. I mean, there's nothing in terms of back support or lateral support or anything like that. It's just a big overstuffed couch, basically. You just sit in it, sink in, and just slide off into the corner. But it's pretty cool. One interesting thing that some of you may not know, lap belts were standard for the front, like you saw earlier, but seat belts are not standard, nor were required during the time of this car's production. So this car does not have rear seat belts. In my two-door sedan I used to have, I actually retrofitted some aftermarket seat belts, but I think I'm just going to leave this the way it is. Adds a little bit of an excitement factor, I guess, but no, just seriously, I believe in keeping the car original and stuff, so I won't be putting that in there. Nor will I really be carrying people too much in this car. As far as the environment back here, it's pretty typical of any car from this era. There's nothing in terms of features or anything like that. You have the window cranks across the doors like I showed you earlier, where you can then roll this into the panel, which is pretty cool. You have some chrome accents across the panel, of course the padded portions just like the front. There's armrest and additional ashtrays back here, so there's three in total. Two across each back portion here and one main one in the dash. But yeah, this car does a pretty good job at accommodating a wide variety of individuals. I mean, there's a lot of leg space down below. You can sit three people back here. Obviously, there's no extra seat belt with no seat belts. There's a pretty good size drivetrain hump right here, but I don't imagine three people of my size would have any problem sitting back here whatsoever. Even people around 6 feet or so, I don't think you're gonna fight for headroom. But yeah, that's pretty much it. So let's go ahead and hop on out and check out the cargo space out back. Out back, the Fairlane gained 2.5 cubic feet of additional trunk space for 1965. The deck lid is opened up by the round key, however, Ford also offered a remote control system for added convenience. It worked by a pull lever mounted to the floor next to the driver's seat. While not equipped on this model, it is available through aftermarket sources, as it was offered on many of Ford's models at the time. The wide and accommodating trunk can stow up to 15 cubic feet of cargo. It's all lined in a houndstooth mat for a nice finishing touch. Cardboard filler panels cover the gaps at the outer edges of the rear quarters, adding to the usable space. Another set of covers are affixed behind the taillight panel to hide the wiring as well as the nuts and bolts that secure the rear trim pieces to the body. A full-size spare tire is mounted towards the back along with your jacking equipment. Well everyone, I hope you enjoyed the in-depth look at the 1965 Ford Fairlane 500 Sports Coupe. Be sure to stay tuned next time, there's a lot more where that came from. Take care, everybody.